Craig's current guest about Professor Molloy from the Francis Crick Institute. And he is here for the third time. I'm very grateful for coming here by you and giving us these fascinating talks. Please welcome him and thank you very much for coming. Things can feel restricted by the time, so particularly time we can find each other's heart later will be cut from the coffee break.
All right. Okay, well, thanks for the invitation, and nice to see everyone. And I'm going to talk about a technique called optical tweezers, which is used to measure very small forces and movements at the level of nanometers and picometers. And so that length scale and force scale is down at the level of the forces and resistances of most proteins, for instance, are maybe about a nanometer, 2 to 5 nanometers across, that sort of dimension. And the forces that are produced by proteins in your muscles, for instance, produce forces of about 10 picometers. Anyway, so more of these, I just want to introduce those terms, these nanometer and picometer, and that's what the whole talk is really about, and how you measure those very small forces of these things. So the plan of the lecture then is to, first of all, introduce optical tweezers and show that they have the correct mechanical properties to enable you to push and pull on single biological macromolecules. So individual proteins, pieces of DNA, lipid membranes, and so other large molecules that you find in biological systems. And as I say, they have the ability to produce forces of about a picometer or so, and to you can control the movement with nanometer precision. So an important aspect of making these measurements is what the time resolution is, because some events in biology will occur over hours or days or years even. Other events in biology will occur on a time scale of maybe picoseconds. And so you need a vast dynamic rate if you want to measure different kinds of event. And the window that we can make these measurements, the time window, is of the order of a few seconds up to maybe a few minutes, down to the scale of about 0.1 milliseconds, about 10 kilohertz. So you can measure events that are fairly brief. Once you get down to this sort of time resolution, 100 kilohertz, that's 10 microseconds, you're down to the time resolution of which molecular rearrangements occur. So if a protein changes conformation, that will take about something like 0.1 microsecond, 100 nanoseconds or something like that. So a protein conformational change is almost within the scope of this measurement technique. So you can almost watch a protein changing shape. The sensitivity of the system is sufficient that you can measure energies which are close to the energy of a single ATP molecule. And I'm sure you're all aware that ATP, adenosine triphosphate, is the source of chemical energy for nearly all biological reactions. And ATP itself, actually, when ATP is converted to ADP and phosphate, that releases about 100 piconewton nanometers. About 10 times thermal energy. Now that's actually rather a miserable amount of work actually from this molecule. Just to put this in context, if you have a bottle of Diet Coke, okay, which says 0 calories on it, in fact, if you look at the label very carefully, it'll tell you that it has about something like 60 kilojoules or something like that. If you drink a whole bottle of a bottle of Diet Coke, which is essentially zero. However, if you have a solution of ATP, 60 kilojoules of energy of ATP is equivalent to 1 molar solution. In other words, you would have to put 600 grams of ATP into your bottle of Coke to get the same amount of energy as Diet Coke. So it really produces very little energy. Each molecule of ATP that's broken down produces very little energy. body, you synthesize about 200 kilograms of ATP every day. It's just a turnover. Okay, so optic tweezers, the nice thing about them, because it's an optical technique using lasers, it's compatible with other optically based systems, in particular the light microscope. So that's a sort of biologist's workhorse. And you can easily introduce optical tweezers into a standard laboratory light microscope. And I'm going to talk to you specifically about a class of proteins called motor proteins, which are the molecules in your cells that carry things around and transport vesicles and other bits of material in the cell. And most proteins are also responsible for producing muscle contraction, so the proteins in your muscle, it's called myosin. I'm going to talk to you a lot about myosin and how that converts ATP into mechanical work. And these motor proteins have been really a model system for development, not only of these optical tweezers system, but also a whole variety of single molecule approaches. And as I say, I'll spend quite a lot of time talking to you about the idea of making measurements from single molecules. And optical tweezers were one of the techniques that led us down to that scale of being able to probe individual molecules. So, since this course is all about lasers and light, we're going to think about now a property of light that you wouldn't normally consider. The fact that light, when it impinges on something, actually produces a very small change in momentum. So when a photon is absorbed, the momentum that it has, streaming forward in a particular direction, is transferred to the object that absorbs it. And that produces a small amount of pressure, photon pressure, which pushes the object away. So when I shine this laser at the screen here, I'm actually pushing that screen backwards. And actually the laser is driving my hand back this way. But the forces are so minute that you just can't detect them at all. So you just think, oh no, that's rubbish, that can't be true, because you just don't experience it. If you go outside on a bright sunny day, and all of the light from the sun is blasting down your body, it pushes you backwards with about a force of 1 milligram. So it's about the same as a fruit fly landing on you. Okay, so it is a very, very small force, but it is nonetheless present. And you can see it in astronomical bodies. So if you look at a comet, for instance, the tail of a comet doesn't stream away. You'd think the comet must be going in this direction over this way. In fact, the comet could be traveling up this way. The reason for the comet trail moving in this direction is the sun pushing the little particles backwards. So the streaming that you see behind a comet is actually caused by photon pressure, not because of the direction of the comet. So now we're going to do our first calculation. So get your pens ready. It all comes from E equals mc squared, but I thought I'd never say that in a lecture being a biologist, but there we are. So that's the master equation. And out of this Einstein's relationship here, we get, just by a small amount of rearrangement, that the momentum of a photon is equal to the energy divided by the speed of light. And if we now want to think about forces, how much force is being produced by a light if it impinges on something, it's the change in momentum, so that's the mass times the velocity of light, divided by time, in other words, the rate of change. And actually that's the power of the laser, the power of the light, P, divided by the velocity. And that's the simple relationship. So the photon pressure is simply the power of the light divided by its velocity. So, fortunately, this thing has written up it somewhere. 3 milliwatts, standard laser. So if I have a 3 milliwatt laser, and I shine it at the board, we can now calculate how much force that's producing. So why don't you have a go at doing that? So 3 milliwatts, that's 3 × 10⁻³, that's the power. And then does anyone know what the speed of light is?
3 × 10⁸
meters per second. Okay. So we've got 3 × 10⁻³ divided by 3 × 10⁸. Did you come up with that one?
10⁻¹.
Very good. Which is like 10 to the 8.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So the force of this little laser is 10 piconewtons. And 10 piconewtons is a very small number. That's why the screen doesn't fly back at these times, of course. Okay, 10 piconewtons, I mean, this is the reason why physicists and biologists got excited by that number, is that 10 piconewtons is enough, actually, that sort of force regime is enough to push and pull on particles that are being moved by thermal energy. So, for instance, when thermal energy was first observed, it was actually observed by a biologist, by Brown, looking down a microscope. He noticed that pollen grains were just moving in solution mysteriously all on their own, not powered by anything, except as the heat in the water that they were sitting in. So the thermal motion of particles, the thermal agitation or diffusion, these are all the same phenomenon, those forces are of the order of a piconewton or so. So if we have a way of getting light focused in on a pollen grain or some particle of that size, we should be able to confine it and stop it from jiggling around and trap it. So that was the idea of producing an optical trap, which would enable you to capture a particle and prevent it from moving by diffusion. And the physicists got interested in this because they wanted to cool particles, so they like to try and cool things down so they get to zero Kelvin, because there's lots of interesting things that happen when you get to zero Kelvin. Biologists want to do it because they want to pick things up and move things around inside cells. So biologists and physicists really got together on this whole scheme. And this, the person that really, he wasn't the first to demonstrate, but the first to produce a practical optical trap was a chap, R. Ashkin. And I mean, it's dated 1971, but it was really in the late 60s that he first experimented with lasers and was able to, well, at first, just take a laser beam. And the nice thing about a laser is it's a very intense source of light. So you take a laser, focus it with a lens, and then he shone it straight into his own eye. I think you should never do. You put a blocking filter in there so you can't get into your eye. And when he did that, he noticed that, and indeed, he looked at pollen grains of bacteria, actually, which were just say, had pollen grains which were sitting in solution, and he also had little bacteria swimming around. And he noticed that when they entered the laser beam, the path of movement was disturbed. And in fact, they started getting pushed in the direction of propagation of light. So he demonstrated then that you could indeed push things through solution using a laser beam. And then fairly speedily after that, he said, well, let's just try and now create that trap so that we can actually capture something and hold it in three dimensions. And the way to do that then, the simplest way to do it, is to take a laser beam from the left and a laser beam from the right, using counter-propagating beams, and where they intersect in the middle, you can imagine one laser is pushing the particle this way, the other laser is pushing the particle that way, and if the beams are diverging, then because the light gets a bit weaker over this way and a bit weaker over that way, it gets then pushed into this central position and then comes to rest in the middle. And so the first demonstration of a three-dimensional optical trap was using this phenomenon of counter-propagating laser beams. And in fact, this configuration is the preferred configuration for physicists working at, using a technique called optical molasses, where they try and slow down and suck out the last bit of energy out of atoms that they're cooling down to zero Kelvin. So they tend to use intersecting laser beams, they'll have about six or even more laser beams, focusing into a single spot to produce optical molasses. But this is, although a cute demonstration, was a bit too complicated for biologists to stick into their light microscope, because you need to have two lenses, you've got to align them accurately, and it was just sort of hopelessly impractical. So the great breakthrough was to come up with what's called the single beam gradient trap. And again, Art Ashkin developed this system. And now we can see how this particular trap, optical trap, works. So the light is coming in from the bottom of the slide here. And rather than being parallel light, which is what's usually coming out of a laser beam, you just put a... I haven't drawn it in here, actually. There should be a... You need to draw in a lens at the bottom here. So you use a lens which focuses the light to a spot. And then when the light enters the particle, and this particle here could either be a bacterium, or it could be a small glass bead or plastic bead, of the order of size, it's the same size as the diffraction limited spot size, so about 500 nanometers or so across. Then when the light enters the particle, if the particle is optically more dense than the medium, the light side. And in fact, as I've drawn it here, this particle works like a little lens. So this, in fact, is the focal length of this particle, and the light's now coming out parallel at the top. So the particle works just exactly like a tiny little lens, which the focus is here, and the light comes out parallel. And if you then inspect the change of momentum at each time it changes from one medium into the other, you'll find that there's a vector which points down this way at this point here, which produces a force out in this direction and a force in that direction. And then at this point, the change of momentum again produces a force in this direction and a little force in that direction. So now we've got a nice property of this gradient track that we have. If you look at all the red forces, which are the lateral forces, those all balance and cancel out. But if we look at the blue forces, we see they're all pushing back up towards the focal spot. But what I've forgotten to add in here is the fact that we don't only get refraction at a particle like this, we also get scattering of light, which goes off in all directions, backwards, forwards, sideways. And that scattering force, F scat, the net effect of the scattering forces is actually to push the particle in the direction of propagation of the light. And at this, to a magic position, the particle rests just below the focus, where the scattering forces exactly balance all of these little forces produced by the gradient forces. Okay, so this now is a three-dimensional track, and the particle will be held in a stable position. It moves up, these forces that exceed this force, it moves down, likewise comes in this way, it moves to the left, it gets pulled to the right, light moves to the left, so it's three-dimensional. And in fact, because the laser spot, when you focus the laser to a diffraction-limited spot, the intensity profiling across the diffraction-limited spot is approximately Gaussian. Okay, so it's bright in the middle and less bright at the edges. And this means that when a particle moves off to one side, so let's consider this spherical particle here. This is the intensity profile of the laser beam. If we imagine the particle moving slightly to the left, we now have more intensity going through this side of the particle than through this side, and so this force is greater than that force, so that pulls it towards the middle, and you can imagine that the same occurs for either left or right. So we have a restoring force, or a reaction force in the particle, which always pushes it towards towards that track center. And in fact, it turns out that the restoring force, which we call F here, is pretty much directly proportional to displacement x. So if you move the particle through a small distance, either to the left or to the right, the restoring force tending to push it back towards the center point here is roughly linear with displacement. And that makes it a very nice mechanical system that's easily characterized, and if you want to make calibrated measurements, we now know that if the bead moves 10 nanometers to the left, or 100 nanometers to the left, or 300 nanometers to the left, we can calculate exactly how many petons is being produced. So this is called a spring-like stiffness, exactly like a spring balance. So if you have a spring balance, when you hang something on the end of the spring extends, and you have a scale, which is just a linear scale here, so we have exactly the same system. And in fact, the stiffness, kappa, of that spring-like stiffness, you can work that out pretty quickly, because we know what the maximum force, this point here, we've already worked that out, okay? So we had 10 picanewtons as a typical maximum force, so 10 picanewtons up there, and the distance over which that's exerted is about the width of the bead, about 500 nanometers, and so the stiffness, kappa, is about 0.02 piconewtons per nanometer. Okay, so these are kind of just stupid numbers that I'm throwing at you, but again, if you were a biologist or someone working on muscle, which I was, that was an exciting number, because we knew that the stiffness of a single myosin molecule, from all sorts of mechanical experiments where you can pull and push on muscle fibers, we knew that the stiffness of a single myosin molecule was about 10 times greater than that, something like 0.2 picanewtons per nanometer. So it's in the very similar range to the optical tweezer, which means that we use the optical tweezers to bend the molecule along this way, to distort them. Okay, so there's a bit more on the physics of the optical trap, because I mentioned time resolution, and time resolution is very important because if you want to make a measurement on a dynamic system, we need to know over what time window we can probe that system. As I said, spectroscopists might be interested in events that occur on picoseconds or femtoseconds, and ecologists might be interested in years or hundreds of years. This is the response time, or the dynamic response of the system that we can create with optical tweezers. And we need to consider this mechanical system, and we do that by putting in this little equation here, which is essentially the equation of motion of this particle. So the particle I've drawn here is held by the optical trap. The optical trap stiffness is represented by a spring, that says kappa. Remember, it had that spring-like restoring force holding the particle in position. But the speed at which the particle can move through water depends on its viscous drag. So you imagine if you stir a cup of tea with a spoon, it's quite easy. You imagine stirring a pot of honey with a spoon, it's a lot more difficult because the viscosity is much higher. And in fact, the viscosity, the viscous drag on this particle, is given by this equation called Stokes' drag. And we know all these parameters. We know pi, obviously. We know the viscosity of water, that's this thing here, and we know the radius of the particle. So we can work out what the viscous drag force on the bead will be. We can also calculate the mass of the bead. And this means that when the bead is subjected to a force, let's say a molecule pulling on it, or a bacterium trying to swim through the solution, we can calculate its mass. And this mass times the acceleration of the particle, ma, that's F, remember F equals ma. So the force due to the mass times acceleration. We can work out the force due to the Stokes drag, so the force equals beta times the velocity of the particle. And then we can work out the force that's due to the spring-like restoring force, which is kappa times the displacement. So there's an x, a dx by dt, a velocity, and a d squared x by dt squared, which is the acceleration. And so acceleration, velocity, and displacement. So now that will enable us to work out the dynamic function. So the particle on a spring is an oscillating system. So if you have imagine a mass just sitting on a spring and you start moving it, it'll bounce up and down, and eventually it'll stop moving. And it stops moving because of the damping, actually. So eventually it comes to rest. And that resonance frequency is given by this equation, kappa over m. And if you do that calculation by knowing the mass of the particle, the resonance frequency of a particle held in an optical trap will be about 50 kilohertz. And it's difficult to make measurements above that resonance frequency. The only way you can do it is to increase the stiffness, turn up the laser power, or reduce the mass, make the particle smaller. And that is the trick to getting to higher and higher time resonance. But the really killing event for the measurements that we will be looking at later is the viscous drag, so this beta term. And in fact, the system is what's called overdamped, because this particle, if you pull suddenly on it, in fact, the motion is not, it doesn't tend to resonate at all. If we go back to that, my ball with a spring, if I have the ball and the spring in air, it bounces up and down, but you can imagine if I put that in water, I let go of the particle, it'll just sort of come up and it comes to a stop, because the drag forces are so gigantic. It might overshoot a little bit. If you put it in honey, it'll just come up and just come to rest. So there's no resonance at all. And this system is like that because it's 50 times smaller than the resonance frequency. So it's what's called overdamped. Okay, so it's an overdamped system, and it has a time resolution for the measurements of about 1 to 2 kilohertz in this, with our standard condition. So that's the physics-y bit. And I know there's some of you are physicists and some of you biologists, and you're of all different disciplines. So I'm trying to, I don't know, please you all, or glaze you all, or whatever. But now we're going to come for the engineers, or people who are interested in building this equipment. How do you actually, we've gone through the theory of how the tweezers work, how do you actually build a thing in practical terms? And the beauty of that gradient trap is it really is incredibly simple to make. You have a laser beam, which is all lasers, it's really wide around the box, has come out beautifully colorized, a nice parallel beam. And you take your laser beam, and you shine it through two lenses, which you usually configure so that f1 and f2 maybe are different by maybe tenfold, so that you can expand the beam and make it wider, up to about 10, this is about a millimeter across. You want the beam to be about 10 millimeters across, so that what fills the back aperture of a microscope objective lens. So if you've ever taken an objective lens off a microscope and looked at it the wrong way around, you'll see that the, where the light comes out at the back end of it is about 10 millimeters across. We want to completely fill that so that the light then is coming in right from the edges and giving us those very steeply angled rays which are responsible for the gradient force. And if you have, if we configure the lenses in this way, where we have a mirror which is the focal distance away from this lens, when we move this mirror, just rotate it backwards and forwards, that will cause the angle of the incident beam to change here. And that actually, what happens then is that this spot scans in position this way, so it moves laterally up and down. As you move this through an angle, this moves through a, displaces through a distance here. And this is what's called a conjugate plane with this plane over here. So this plane is conjugate with that. In other words, whatever happens here, exactly the same thing happens over here. But it's scaled down by the magnification of this projector plane. So it could be 1,000 times smaller. So if this spot moves, let's say, by a centimeter here, it would be 1,000 microns over here, which would be the field of view of your light microscope. So that's it, simple. But of course, it always gets more complicated. When you want to build an instrument that will make measurements, moving mirrors, if you want to go and capture a bacteria or something, moving a mirror with some knobs you've got to turn with your fingers, it's just too difficult. It's just mechanically very awkward. And so we tend to use these electrical devices or electro-optic devices, I don't call them acousto-optic devices, in order to steer the laser beam and change its angle. And this is the trick, really, to making optical tweezers into an instrument that you can make high-precision measurements. So I'll just tell you very briefly about acousto-optic deflectors. I don't know if they've come up at other times in this course. But they're the same family of devices as acousto-optical tunable filters, AOTFs, which can be used for selecting different wavelengths of laser light. And the device, though, that we use is what's called an AOD, an acousto-optic deflector, or it's often changed to an acousto-optic device. But these deflectors are able to move a laser beam through an angle of about 3 degrees or something like that. So a very small angle, but we can amplify that with our mirrors and lenses. And the way that it works is to have a crystal, which is usually made of some exotic material, but in fact quartz, glass, will work. So if you take a piece of quartz and you cut it into a perfect cube, put a piezoelectric actuator on one side of it, and then a dampening material on the other, often a piece of aluminium just glued onto the face, then if you oscillate the piezoelectric device here at about a megahertz, it produces a traveling acoustic wave through the material, and that's actually dumped out into your absorbing material on the other side. So it's a traveling wave, and it has a particular wavelength here. So we now have little regions of this glass, some of which are compressed and some of which are slightly rarefied. And if we shine the laser beam through it, it will be diffracted by that, essentially this optical grating here. And if the crystal is quite thick, up to about a centimeter thick, you can dump about 70 or 80% of the light into the first order diffraction line. And then if we change the frequency, so this is just, we just turn a knob now on our electronics, then we change the spacing. As we change the spacing, we change this angle, theta, and we've deflected the beam through a different angle. Now the beauty of this, of course, is that now we have an electrical way of changing the position of the light. And as soon as we get an electrical method, rather than that hand-twiddling method, we can now move the laser spot very, very rapidly, in about 1 microsecond. So you can move the spot of light wherever you want in position with about 1 microsecond of time resolution. In fact, it's governed by the transit time of this acoustic wave. So that's the trick to steering it. Of course, any instrument is always going to be much more complicated. So realistically, things are always more complicated. So you might have an objective lens, all sorts of other lenses and lamps and computers and monitors and cameras. And also the critical part is actually this side, rather hidden, which is a detector system of some sort, which enables this again is another of the standard laser optics. It occurs in numerous laser devices, which is where you want to measure the position of a laser spot very accurately. And the quickest and easiest way of doing that is to shine the laser beam onto a photodiode detector. And typically we'll have four quadrants, so four sensitive areas. So this would be photodiode number one, photodiode number two, three, and four. And each one of those photodiodes goes to a little amplifier. And then by plugging those amplifiers together and reading them into a computer, you can work out the ratio of one and three to two and four. That tells you the displacement in X and Y. And the ratio of the sum of one and three to two and four, one and two to three and four. And that will tell you the displacement in Y. So you can compute then the position of this particle either upwards or to the side, in other words, in two dimensions. And as the particle moves across the detector, as is shown here, you can imagine that the signal goes through a null point when it's exactly in the middle. And as you displace it off to one side, at this position here, it will give you the maximum deflection. And then as you move further off to the side, it starts coming down, and it goes down to zero. And you can imagine there's an equivalent set of these to explain this part of the response. And you'll notice again that there's a nice linear response over the central section in this region here, shown that this is actually the output from the detector. So over a reasonable range of about 500 nanometers, the system is linear. So we can measure the position of the bead either in X or Y with very high precision. So the scale here, this is measured actually in nanometers now, so the volts are converted to nanometers just by calibration. And in fact, most of the measurements that we want to make are going to be almost down the axis down here in the 10 nanometer. So now we have our particle, we've captured it, and we're going to do something with it. We're going to use it to make some biological measurements. We're going to capture a glass bead or a plastic bead, and we're going to stick it to a piece of DNA, and we're going to pull the DNA, or we're going to stick it to a bacterium and measure how much force its flagellar motor generates. Or we'll bind it to a single myosin molecule and see how much force it produces when it pulls. And when we want to do those measurements, we need to get right down to the limit of the thermal noise. And so I'm just going to explain a little bit about thermal noise, again, because it's a common theme, and nearly all the measurements in at high resolution are governed by what we call the thermal limit. And one way around the thermal limit is just to cool things down. If you remove heat, then things will just start freezing and not moving anymore. So one option is to just cool the system to remove thermal noise. And that's what physicists do. Biologists, we can't do that because the systems that we're working on are usually living systems and they have to be in aqueous solution at room temperature or thereabouts. And so we're stuck with the thermal noise. Remember, the T here is the absolute temperature. Kb is Boltzmann's constant. And if we know what the thermal energy is, Kb times T, that's the single molecule equivalent of RT, universal gas constant times temperature. If we know what the thermal energy of a single molecule is, we can work out how much it will move when it's held in the optical trap because of this thing called the principle of equipartition of energy, which says that the amount of energy that's being in the mechanical part of the work versus the energy which is in the thermal part. And so there's just an exchange between thermal energy and mechanical energy. And just due to thermodynamics, the things on average have to balance equal, essentially equal zero at an infinite time. And so if we look at our particle that's held in the optical trap with time, so there's time along this axis, and this is the position of a particle held in an optical trap, you find rather than just sitting, when I explained it to you, it sounded like it was going to be trapped and held rigidly, but it's still being jiggled by the water that it's bathed in, and so it still moves by a little bit. And in fact, this movement that you see here is the movement of the bead due to its thermal energy. And that thermal energy, if you take all of that data and plot it as a histogram down here, has a root mean squared deviation. In other words, this histogram of positions has a root mean squared deviation of about 14 nanometers. And if you do Temperature we can measure very accurately, so we know exactly what the thermal energy of the particle is. And since we know the thermal energy, and since we knew that equipartition principle, then we can work out what the stiffness of the trap is from just simply measuring over a long period of time the amplitude of this thermal noise. And if we do that at, let's say, three different laser powers, we just go from low power, medium power, to high power, you notice that the amplitude gets smaller and smaller. And you notice also that the frequency response gets better and better. Remember that as we increase kappa, it's the ratio of kappa to beta, which determines, or kappa to m, which determines the frequency response of the system. And in this plot, which is a power spectrum, the Fourier transform of this data, we can see that the amplitude goes down, the amplitude squared here, and the frequency response moves to the right, goes to higher and higher frequencies. So it does what we expect. High laser power, as it were, is good, because it has fast frequency response and low thermal noise. Now let's see it working. So this is sort of a typical, most of these devices are custom made. You can now buy commercial optical traps, and there are two or three companies which will sell you an optical tweezers apparatus. But for any of them, they all work on exactly the same principles. Essentially, there'll be a box with some laser, or with a laser in. There'll be a light microscope. There'll be, which is usually an inverted microscope, so the objective lens looks upwards at this point. And then it will have some sort of detector system, which is shown here, which are the four quadrant photodiodes to measure the position of the objects that you've captured. And okay, in the video that you can see playing over the top here, or you can see various phenomena, you can see these little particles moving. Okay, so those are just diffusing. These are plastic beams about 1 micrometer across. And just as Brown observed 200 years ago, these things just diffuse in solution. But these four particles are clearly doing something different. And that's because we've got four spots of laser light. And each spot of laser light we've captured one of those particles. And you can see they're held not only in X and Y, but they're also held in Z, because you can see that the focus of those particles remains fixed in this way. It remains nice dark center, dark particles. Whereas these other particles are going in and out of focus and they're moving to left and right. So there we've got our system now for manipulating not just one, but you can manipulate multiple particles. And you do multiple particles by using that acousto-optic deflector, because I said we could control that electrically. So the nice thing then is you can say, well, let's say we'll have two traps. But what we can do is we can put the trap over here, leave it there for a little while, and then we'll move it over here, leave it there for a while, move back over here, and we'll switch between two different positions, or three different positions, or four different positions. That's called multiplexing. And in fact, if you just enter in a whole load of coordinates, you can make the laser beam drop around into all different positions, and it will go around, grab hold of this particle, it'll move away and hold this particle, this one starts to diffuse, but it'll come back again so quickly that it grabs it straight back into the trap again. So you make use of the viscous delay in order to keep all of the particles captured. So that's what's happening in this system here. So at any one time, only one of them is being trapped. They serve it so rapidly that they're all constrained. Okay. So now what can we do with it? So over the years, optical tweezers has been used, well, in fact, it was used initially to measure the compliance of bacterial flagellae. So what they did was to take a bacterium and stick it down onto a microscope cover slip, stick a particle onto one of its little flagella, what they often call tails, but they're actually called helical projection off the back end of the bacterium, which rotates in order to drive the bacterium forward. And they stuck a bead on that, and because they stick it on the side, the bead tends to go around in an elliptical manner. So if you grab hold of it, you can stop the flagella from rotating. And you'd say, why do such a crazy thing? Well, the nice thing is, if you're interested in how the flagella motor works, the little machine which rotates the bacterial flagella, that works like a little turbine, and it's taking protons, and the flux of protons going through the membrane, and through this motor is the thing that turns it in a rotary manner. And the big question in that field was, how does that rotor actually rotate around, and how is the coupling between the flux of protons and the movement of those protons, how does that work? And so And you can imagine models for an electrical motor, some of which like a stepper motor, which is very clicky and moves in discrete steps. Others which might be more like a sort of shaped pole motor, which would move in a much more smooth manner. Anyway, it turns out, in fact, this question remained open for about 20 years, and it was only about 5 or 8 years ago that the key measurement was made, and indeed it does go around in discrete steps, but they're very fast and very small. There are 22 steps going around, so the motor actually has 22 units, and each time a proton or a flux of protons goes through, it clicks by one movement by one 20-second rotation. So you can also stick it onto a piece of DNA, and there you might be interested in proteins that move along DNA and perform things like transcription or translation. And we know that those proteins, of course, move along unwinding the DNA and copying it and so on. And there's a whole load of questions that you might be interested there in how the proteins move along DNA. And the field of interest, well, my particular field of interest is how proteins move along the cytoskeletal elements. So how kinesins move along microtubules and how myosins move along actin. And so there, the big question is how is the ATP, the chemical fuel, converted into discrete steps of these motors as they move along the cytoskeletal element. And so that hope is to be able to see them stepping. And then finally, you could use it, let's say, for